Shenoy is a practicing obstetrician and a gynecologist and a medical legal consultant. Sir is currently an honorary assistant professor of obstetrics and gynecology at the KJ Somaiya Hospital and Medical College, Mumbai. Dr. Shenoy was the president of the College of Physicians and Surgeons of Bombay and has over 14 original research papers to his credit. Sir has been awarded a number of prizes by the legal fraternity. Prominent among them are the prestigious Bar Council Silver Jubilee Prize and Sir Chiminlal Setalwad Golden Jubilee Prize, awarded by the Bar Council of Maharashtra and Goa. Dr. Shenoy has authored 3 books on medical negligence. A prolific writer on medical law, writings by Shenoy sir have been quoted verbatim along with his name by the Chief Justice of India, Justice Lahoti, in his judgment. I request my colleague to present sir with a token of our appreciation. I call upon Dr. Shenoy sir to address the crowd on medical negligence, what a medical student should know.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. I don't have any slides, no transparencies, I just speak. I want the full lights on. Everything on. Everything on. Please, make it bright. That's right. That makes me comfortable. Okay, friends. It's always been a pleasure to come to SIAM. You know, I was a product of Nair Hospital. And, entered the medical school in 1971. That's quite a long time now. Our batch people, has had one of the best times ever when it came to practicing the medical profession. Because of late, the things are absolutely different. You know, something which is, lesser the said, the better. Why do I say this? I say this because I was a judge on the consumer courts for a long time. I retired as a judge in the year 2002. At that point of time, when we were adjudicating, we used to adjudicate upon all kinds of problems. We used to have a case of medical negligence, one case approximately once in 15 days. So, after demitting office, that is practically, it is around 14 years now that I've left the bench. Today, if you see the board of the consumer courts, there you have 3 cases every day. That means a matter of 15 days, there are approximately 45 cases. What I want to tell you all, friends, is that the incidence of medical negligence cases in the courts have gone up from 1 to 45. You know, a time will soon come, maybe in another 5 years' time, when I can very confidently say that there won't be any one of us without a case of medical negligence behind us. So it's something that you have to accept. Today, if at all there's a case of medical negligence, you are a little concerned. You don't want others to know. But maybe in another 10 years from now, you know, at cocktail parties, the discussion will be, one will say, I've got 3 against me, and the other one will say, I've got 7 against me. And you know, the thing is, the number of cases against you, the more the cases, it will be believed that the kind of practice you have is fantastic. More the practice, more the cases. That is the way it's going to be. And correctly, it is going to be like that. So medical negligence problems are bound to come, and you've got to accept it. And you still have to practice because it's going to be a part of your practice. Now, I'm addressing the students, remember, because this title itself says so. So I presume the students, as it comes to law, must be knowing very little. So I'll give you a small background about the law first before I go into the topic that I'm going to address you on. See, basically law is of 2 types. The first type is known as a statutory law. What do you mean by a statutory law? Statutory law is the law that the parliamentarians at the center, or maybe the people sitting in the assembly at the state level, they enact. For example, the Maharashtra Medical Council Act is a statutory law. It has been made by the assembly. And the Consumer Protection Act is a central law which has been made by the parliament. So this is a statutory law. As against statutory law, there's another kind of a law. The second kind of a law is known as a judge-made law. Judges also make laws. You know, a judge of the superior court, when he lays down a particular decision on a particular point of law, that has the force of law which becomes enforceable to all courts inferior in hierarchy. Well, difficult to understand, so I'll explain. Whether we doctors come within the ambit of the Consumer Protection Act or not was a grey area. Some courts believed we came, some courts believed we did not come. This matter finally went to the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court is the apex court as far as we are concerned. And the Supreme Court laid down the law and said, we doctors very much come within the ambit of the Consumer Protection Act, where most of the medical legal negligence matters are adjudicated. Therefore, this becomes a judgment law which is settled on that particular point, and all the courts inferior in hierarchy to the Supreme Court, that means practically every court in India, is bound to follow that law. Now, I'm supposed to address you all on the law of medical negligence. Medical negligence, therefore, is what kind of a law? Is it a statutory law or is it a judgment law? And sadly, I say that the law of medical negligence is a judgment law. It is the judges who tell us what is negligence and what is not negligence, and that is where the problem comes in. See, I've been practicing obstetrics for the past 40 years now. Many a times, I myself do not understand why a particular thing happens. I just can't understand, can't fathom. And just imagine, the prosecution is going to talk about the case for half an hour. The defense advocate is going to speak about the case for another half an hour. And the judge, who is absolutely a person who does not understand anything about the law, he is going to tell us what is correct and what is not correct. That is where the problem is. And it is because of this, many a times, there are some very bad judgments given which somehow stick and they become a thorn in our flesh when it comes to practicing medicine. Okay, with that small introduction, I'll give you another small introduction. We are taken to the courts for a wrong that we do, something wrong. So what are the different kinds of wrongs that are possible? The first kind of a wrong that the courts look into is something known as a legal wrong. Okay, the second kind of a wrong that is very much possible is known as an ethical wrong. And the third kind of a wrong is known as a moral wrong. Now, legal wrongs basically are adjudicated or decided in the courts of law. Ethical wrongs are decided where? In the medical councils. Remember, there is something known as a medical council with whom you have got to register yourself before you practice medicine, start practicing medicine. And this happens the moment you start internship. When you start internship, there is something known as provisional registration that you've got to take from the medical council. And therefore, if at all there's an ethical wrong, then the medical council will adjudicate it. And the third wrong is a moral wrong. Moral wrongs, if at all there are any, these moral wrongs are adjudicated in the temples or churches or in the gurudwaras or all those things. It is the priest who tells you, this is the punishment that I'm giving you for something which is morally wrong that you have done. With this, let's come to the topic. Now, I've told you roughly what the thing is. Now, the law of medical negligence, I told you, is a judgment law. It is the judges who tell us. Therefore, what do you mean by negligence? Negligence is very simple. It can be either an act or it can be an omission. Act means you have done something which a reasonable, prudent doctor would never do. Like, for example, you have operated and you've kept a mop inside the patient and you've closed the patient. Subsequently, the second surgeon removes the mop. Now, leaving a mop inside a patient is something which any reasonable, prudent doctor would never do, and you have done it. It is an act of commission. What do you mean by an act of omission? Act of omission means you have omitted to do something which a reasonable, prudent doctor would do. For example, I'll give you a very simple example. There is a patient of central placenta previa, bang central placenta previa, running into the anterior segment of the uterus, anterior wall of the uterus, and you are supposed to do a section. You say, I'm such a good surgeon, I don't want blood, and you don't keep blood ready. The textbooks always say, whenever there's a case of placenta previa, you must keep blood ready because you never know, and you don't. And the patient bleeds and bleeds and bleeds, and there is no blood available to be given to the patient. Now, this is an act of omission. You have omitted to keep blood, which any other reasonable, prudent doctor would not do. Correct, na? I would keep blood ready and then take up a patient of a placenta previa. This is known as an act of omission. So if at all you do something which is an act of commission or an act of omission, acts which some reasonable doctor would do, acts some reasonable doctor would not do, then in the eyes of law, you have been negligent. That is what it is. Now see, things are not all that easy. If at all it's a mop or it's a blood or it's a preoperative assessment of the patient not done, it is very simple. Anybody can say it is an act of omission or an act of commission. But there are certain other things which the courts lay down, which are very important and which must be known to us. And that is, for the first time, the court gives its mind on a particular proposition, which sometimes we feel is absolutely against the teachings of what our textbooks tell us, right? I'll give you a very simple example. A very nice example I'll give you. See, once upon a time, what used to happen was, every Tom, Dick and Harry in the profession, whether it is an Ayurvedic doctor or a homeopathic doctor or an allopathic doctor or a Yunani doctor, used to write allopathic medicines. You know, the court came out with a law on this, and that law is based on a very beautiful decision that took place. So whenever there's a decision given, a law settled, there always is a case, and based on that case, the court comes out with a particular decision. This is that famous decision that has come out with a new, very new concept. This happened in the year 1995. A new terminology got introduced in medical law, and that terminology was cross-pathy practice. Now, what do you mean by cross-pathy practice? The law says there are four established schools of medicines only, and the four established schools of medicines are allopathy, homeopathy, Ayurveda, and Unani. And the law says that if at all you are a graduate of one particular school, you must restrict your practice only to that school, and you should not jump schools. That is what the law says. And this is this famous case, what actually happened was, there was one patient who was running temperature. When the patient was running temperature, he went to his doctor, and his doctor was one Dr. Ashwin Patel, who was a homeopath. Dr. Ashwin Patel investigated him and came to the conclusion that he was running viral fever, and so he gave Ashwin Patel ciprofloxacin along with paracetamol. Within a day or two, the fever subsided, but on day three, the fever started coming up again. The moment this happened, Dr. Ashwin Patel rightly referred him to one of the tertiary care centers. The patient got admitted to the tertiary care center, and finally, the patient expired in the tertiary care center. Once the patient expired, the widow was very angry. The widow said, "Well, you are a homeopath, and what you have done is you have prescribed allopathic medicine, so you have done something which is wrong." And the widow filed a case against Dr. Ashwin Patel. The matter was heard by the National Commission because it went directly to Delhi. What National Commission did was, it referred the entire file to All India Institute of Medical Sciences. And the AIIMS, All India Institute of Medical Sciences, gave an opinion and said, "Well, Dr. Ashwin Patel has done nothing wrong. He has practiced the way a reasonable, prudent man would practice. He has got the patient investigated, and the medicines that he has given is perfect." Based on the AIIMS report, what National Commission did is, National Commission dismissed the complaint. The moment the National Commission dismissed the complaint, the widow was very angry. The widow said, "No, injustice has been done to me," and she went into appeal to the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court for the first time changed the National Commission judgment and came out with this particular law. The National Commission, the Supreme Court said, "Well, if at all you are a graduate from one particular school of medicine, you must restrict your practice only to that school, and you must not jump specialties." Why am I telling this? I'm telling you this is because many times we are allopaths, right? We are from the allopathic school of medicine. You should restrict your practice only to your school of medicine, and you must not jump schools. You must not prescribe Ayurvedic medicines. You should not prescribe homeopathic medicines, or you should not prescribe Unani medicines. So restrict yourself only to this particular school that you are trained in. Remember, ladies and gentlemen, apart from these four schools, are there any other schools of medicine? The answer is, there is no other school of medicine apart from these four. Whatever you hear, acupuncture, acupressure, there is something known as magnetotherapy, there is something known as aromatherapy, you know, there is something known as electrotherapy, there is something known as yoga. Are these schools of medicines? Answer is no, they are not schools of medicines. Best you can call them as sciences, paramedical sciences, but they definitely are not schools of medicines. You know, amongst these paramedical schools or paramedical sciences, you know who is the luckiest amongst all these paramedical sciences? The person who gives acupressure is the luckiest. You know why? Because most of them give pressure at such unwanted places, only they get relief. You know, nobody else gets relief. So that is what I have always been saying. So you have to restrict yourself only to the school that you have been trained in. Jumping schools will amount to negligence in the eyes of law and will be actionable in the sense that you may have to pay compensation. I'll give you another law that the Supreme Court has laid down, which is totally against our teachings. And what is that? That is with respect to confidentiality. Remember, we have always been taught in forensic medicine that whatever we come to know with respect to a patient, whilst we are treating a patient, should be kept confidential, and this information should never be given to somebody else. Remember, the forensic textbooks go to the extent of saying that if at all this particular information has got to be given, it can be only given in the court of law, and that too, it has got to be given under protest. That's what the books say. Now, I will give you a hypothetical situation. I'm telling you how there's a change in law and how the Supreme Court starts thinking, and they keep on changing their thoughts with respect to the environment and the time. Now, see, I'll give you a hypothetical situation. You are a family physician. Well, the entire family comes to you. the husband is not keeping well. And the husband comes to you, you get the husband investigated and you find out that the husband is HIV positive. The moment you understand that the husband is HIV positive, the tendency is that you will counsel him. You will tell him, now there is a possibility that you will infect your wife. So you've got to be careful. Now you've got to use condoms. You cannot have open sex. All these things you will tell. The moment this happens, the husband goes home. Husband understands. And all of a sudden, the husband starts using a condom whenever he has sex with his wife. You know, wives are very intelligent, remember. Huh? All of them, all of us feel that, well, they don't understand, but they're very intelligent. The moment the wife sees that her husband, a person who never liked condoms, has suddenly started using condoms, she starts thinking that there's something wrong. And the only person that she comes is to her family physician. She comes to her GP and she asks the family physician, is my husband having a problem? Because a person who never liked condoms has suddenly started using condoms. What is wrong with him? Tell me. Now, there are only two options available to the family physician, correct? One option is he tells her that your husband is HIV positive. The second option that is available to him is he says, you bring your husband to me. If your husband gives me consent, then I will tell you exactly what has happened to your husband. Which of the two options is correct? The second one. That is what most of the people say. But the second option is not correct. It is the first option that is correct. That is, the husband can tell the wife when she comes to him saying that, well, your husband is HIV positive. This is the change in the law that has come in, because I told you the law of medical negligence is a judgment law, and it is the judges who tell us what is negligence and what is not negligence and what is the practice that you are supposed to adopt when you are practicing medicine. Now, how has this law changed is something that you must understand. And this is that famous ectopy case. Now, here what happened, I tell you. There was a person who was suffering from aortic aneurysm and he had to be operated. He had a very close friend by the name of Dr. Yeptomi. This happened in Nagaland. So from Nagaland, both Dr. Yeptomi and the patient suffering from aortic aneurysm came to Madras and entered Apollo Hospital where he was supposed to be operated. Well, blood was required. Aortic aneurysm is a big surgery. So what happened is Dr. Yeptomi said, you are my friend, I donate one bottle. And Yeptomi donated one bottle. And when they investigated that blood, they identified that Yeptomi was HIV positive. The moment Yeptomi was HIV positive, what they did, they discarded that blood sample. The surgery went off very well. Both of them went back to Nagaland. Now in Nagaland, what happened? At that point of time, this Dr. Yeptomi got engaged to a very beautiful girl by the name of Miss Akali. Well, small place, everybody came to know, Dr. Saib is getting engaged. Doom dam, you know, everybody came to know. Everybody was very happy. But after the engagement, what happened was, the in-laws, Miss Akali's parents, started hearing something. And that hearing was, their would-be son-in-law is HIV positive. The moment they heard this, what they did was, they took the first available flight, came straight to Apollo Hospital, Madras, met the CEO there, and told the CEO, see, we are the parents of Miss Akali, and this is what we are hearing. Is it true? We want to know. Otherwise, our girl's life is in danger. The CEO was a very nice person, so what he did was, he called for the files and he opened the files in front of the parents of Miss Akali and said, yes, this Dr. Yeptomi, your would-be son-in-law, is HIV positive. The moment this kind of an information was made available to Yeptomi's parents, to Akali's parents, they took the next flight back to Nagaland, and the first thing that they did was, they broke the engagement. And when they broke the engagement, the entire town came to know that this Yeptomi was HIV positive. Sarvaguna Sampanna, you know, HIV positive. So, moment it was HIV positive, what happened? The condition was so bad for Yeptomi that he practically had to pack up Boria Bistar and he left Nagaland and came and stayed in Madras, and from there he filed a complaint directly before the National Commission in Delhi. His contention was very simple. His contention is, the information that I was HIV positive is a confidential information. Nobody can part away with this confidential information without my consent. And Apollo Hospital is a hospital that has broken this routine. They have given this particular information to my would-be in-laws, as a result of which today I've lost faith in my own place. I can't go back to my town. And today the situation has become so bad that nobody is going to give me their daughter in marriage. So great inconvenience has been caused to me, and therefore I must be paid compensation. This was the issue. Now the National Commission heard this matter, and the National Commission said, this is too complicated an issue for us to decide because a lot of evidence needs to be gathered, as the result of which you go to a civil court. The moment this kind of a decision was given by the National Commission, what Dr. Yeptomi did, he went into appeal in the Supreme Court and he told the Supreme Court about his problems. And the Supreme Court for the first time laid down the law that I told you. And the Supreme Court said, what Apollo Hospital Madras has done is perfectly correct. There is nothing wrong about it. So parting away with this kind of a information, which the Apollo Hospital did without the consent of Dr. Yeptomi, the Supreme Court said that there was nothing wrong in it. Listen to me, friends. Whenever the Supreme Court gives a judgment, there is always a reasoning behind that judgment. It tells you why it is so. And do you know what is the reasoning given in this particular case? The Supreme Court said, in this particular case, there are two rights involved, correct? On one side is Miss Akali's right to life. And on the other side is Dr. Yeptomi's right to confidentiality. And the Supreme Court said that whenever there is a clash between these two rights, the right to life will always override the right to confidentiality. And therefore, giving this information, there is nothing wrong. Had this information not been given, then what would have happened? This particular marriage would have consummated. And then what would have happened? Miss Akali, who is today HIV negative, would have one fine morning become HIV positive, as the result of which her lifespan automatically would have reduced. She would have died prematurely. And therefore, this particular step taken by Apollo Hospital was correct. See, this is the change that is there. The courts change what we have been taught all these times. And that is why you've got to be abreast with the latest judgments of the court, because the law of medical negligence is a judgment law. And every time there's a decision, there are certain changes in the routine practice that we people follow. Okay, now I'll tell you another change that has taken place. And then I will give you something more interesting. Another change that has taken place, very, very drastic change, is on the law of consent. What do you mean by consent, friends? My student colleagues over here. See, consent is the permission that the patient gives to you to do a certain thing on the patient. Like, for example, you need to remove an appendix. You've got to take a consent from the patient, and then you can proceed and remove the appendix. Now, once upon a time, that is prior to this particular Samira Kohli judgment, there was no law which said that a written consent was mandatory. There was no law. Why do I say this? I say this is because of a very beautiful case that was decided that settled this point. The case was, there was a patient who had an adenoma in the thyroid. That adenoma was bothering the patient, as a result of which it had to be operated. So a hemithyroidectomy had to be done. That is, half of the thyroid was to be removed. The patient got investigated and subsequently got admitted to a hospital. And then the patient walked to the operation theater, and the patient subjected herself to anesthesia, and the surgeon opened her neck. The hemithyroidectomy went off very smoothly. There was no problem. But when the patient was being reversed, when the patient was to come out of anesthesia, this particular patient just would not be reversed. The anesthetist couldn't bring the patient back to her senses. Anesthetist couldn't bring the patient back out of anesthesia. Could not be reversed. And finally, the patient died on the table. This matter went to the court. I'm talking on the law of consent, remember. This matter went to the court. Now, in the court, what happened? One of the allegations made by the patient's people, the legal heirs of the patient, was that my patient was operated without a consent. That was one of the things. Mind you, amongst other things, even this thing was adjudicated by the court, and the court said it doesn't matter if a written consent was not there. The court said if written consent is not there, it can always be presumed that implied consent was present. See, consents are of two types. One is a written consent where you sign on a document allowing the doctor to operate upon you. If at all that is not present, as it was in this particular case, the court said that there is something known as implied consent. Now, what do you mean by implied consent? Implied consent means, the court said, it can never be believed, it can never be even imagined, that the doctor literally went on the streets, dragged the patient to the operation theater, forced anesthesia on her, and opened up her neck. It cannot even be presumed. The very fact that the patient got herself admitted, walked into the operation theater, allowed the anesthetist to give anesthesia, and allowed the surgeon thereafter to open the neck, says that the patient was willing for this particular surgery. So implied consent was present, and based on this implied consent, this particular case was won. But this happened prior to 2008. In the year 2008, the law on consent changed, and this is that famous Samira Kohli case. I'll tell you what happened here. In the Samira Kohli's case, what happened? There was a perimenopausal spinster, you know, unmarried, around 46 years of age. And she was suffering from severe dysmenorrhea and severe menorrhagia during her periods. Well, she went to her gynecologist by the name of Prabha Manchanda. Prabha Manchanda examined her and said, well, you are suffering from something known as adenomyosis. And she, endometriosis, that's what she said. And she also said that the extent of endometriosis cannot be identified by clinical examination, but we will have to put in a scope and see how much is the extent. If the endometriosis is of a small amount, we will fulgurate it, we will burn it. But if at all it is large and there is complete plastering of the pelvis, then maybe we may have to do a hysterectomy on you. She said yes. She got admitted to the hospital and gave consent for a diagnostic laparoscopy, SOS fulguration. Prabha Manchanda put in the scope. When she put in the scope, she identified that the entire pelvis was plastered. Nothing could be done. So Prabha Manchanda told her colleague who had washed up to unwash, go and speak to the mother, because she was not married. Go and speak to the mother and tell her that we will have to go in for a hysterectomy. The junior went out, spoke to the mother, and you know how mothers are, aapko kya sahi lagta hai wo karo. You know, that is a standard reply that is given. So what Prabha Manchanda did, the surgeon did, the surgeon opened up the abdomen and jhadu maar diya. Jhadu maar diya means uterus, tubes, ovaries, pelvis, cervix and upper part of the vagina. Everything was removed off. And well, the surgery went off okay and everything was all right. On day 3, Samira Kohli came to her senses, absolutely perfect. And she asked the doctor, what did you do? And the doctor said, I have removed your uterus, your ovaries, your tubes and your cervix and a small part of your vagina. I had to remove it because we couldn't do anything. The moment that was said, Samira Kohli blew her top. She said, how dare you do it? What was the permission given? What was the consent given to you? Was only for a diagnostic laparoscopy, SOS, fulguration. And you've removed everything that is there. So now today, I wanted to get married. And today it is, and I wanted also to have children. But what you have done today will deprive me of that pleasure. You know, she had to wait for 46 years for this. But when it comes to a litigation, they make all kinds of allegations. So this matter went to the Supreme Court. And the Supreme Court for the first time changed the law on consent. Today the law of consent says that if at all you are going to do anything invasive on the patient, then a written consent is mandated. So today if at all you operate upon a patient without a written consent, that can go against you, because the Supreme Court has settled the law on consent that you should not operate upon a patient without a written consent. The only exception to this rule is that if at all you identify something which is not in good status for the patient. For example, suppose you open up a patient and you find that there is a twisted ovarian cyst. If this is the case, then well, you can extend the scope of surgery and remove the twisted ovarian cyst without the express consent of the patient. Only in those conditions, today the law of consent has been changed. Today the law of consent as it stands is, you must operate upon a patient only with a written consent. Not doing so would be actionable. You may have to pay compensation for it. So this is roughly what is negligence. Now I'll tell you something which is more interesting. What is this something which is more interesting? Something which is more interesting is to understand what is not negligence, because that is going to be your defense in the courts of law tomorrow. So what is not negligence? And in this, the first group of what is not negligence is, if at all you have practiced the way your peers advise you to practice, if at all you have practiced the way your textbooks recommend you to practice, then whatever may be the end result, this end result in the eyes of law is not negligence. I'll give you a very simple example. There was a patient who delivered, and then she went home. Within 3 months, she got pregnant again. And this time, when she got pregnant, she understood that she was pregnant. She went back to the obstetrician and told the obstetrician, I am pregnant, but my child is just 3 months and I don't want this pregnancy. It was an unwanted pregnancy. So what the gynecologist said is, we'll go in for a termination of pregnancy. She gave consent. Routine investigations like urine, hemoglobin, blood group was done, and the patient was taken up for an MTP. The moment the MTP was started, the gynecologist identified that the moment she put in the dilator, she understood that this particular pregnancy was not an intrauterine pregnancy, but it was a cervical pregnancy. You know, and those who have already done the gynectomy will understand. Normally, when the pregnancy is within the uterus, and the moment it gets dislodged, the myometrium contracts. And when the myometrium contracts, what happens? The blood vessels literally get strangulated. Correct, na? But in the cervix, there is no myometrium. As a result of which, when you dislodge a cervical pregnancy, the sinuses are opened out and they bleed like a tap. And this is exactly what happened in this case. The patient really bled and bled, so much so that the obstetrician had no choice but to open up the patient and do a hysterectomy. And that was exactly done to help the patient tide over the crisis. Well, patient went home, everything was fine. And after 3 months, when she was perfect, she sent a legal notice. Normally the notices are sent after the doctor's services are taken to the, you know, last bit. And in the legal notice, what was mentioned was, well, you did not do an ultrasonography prior to MTP. Had you done an ultrasonography prior to MTP, this cervical pregnancy would have been identified. And the moment the cervical pregnancy was identified, we would have been in a better position to tackle this kind of a problem. This is an act of omission on your part, not doing an ultrasonography, an act of omission. So you pay us compensation. The moment this kind of a prayer was made, the request was made in the notice, the doctor said, 100% I'm not going to pay you a single rupee. The moment the doctor said that, what happened was, the case was filed in the court. And in the court, this case was defended by the doctors. The doctor said that not doing an ultrasonography is the way I have been taught in the medical colleges. This is the practice that is followed by the fraternity. This is the teachings of my peers. So whenever you have to tell the court that this is the way I have been taught, what is the best way of justifying your statement? What is the best evidence that you can give to the courts? Are the standard textbooks, correct? So what here the doctor did was, she picked up MTP chapters from 3 standard textbooks and placed it on the record of the court and told the court, all these 3 books do not say that doing a routine ultrasonography prior to every MTP is mandatory. So what I have done is, I have followed what my textbooks recommend, what I have learned and what I teach, as the result of which, not doing an ultrasonography definitely does not amount to negligence on my part. This the courts accepted, and the court said, yes, what you have done is correct, and not a single rupee was paid as compensation. This case was won by the doctors. So what I am trying to tell you is, if at all you have practiced the way your textbooks recommend you to practice, the way your peers recommend you to practice, and something goes wrong, that something going wrong essentially in the eyes of law does not amount to negligence or deficiencies in the services that you have been rendered in. Therefore, how do you tell the court that what you have done is as per the standard teaching protocols? The first way is standard textbooks. I've told you just now. If the standard textbook is silent on a particular proposition, then what do you do? Then you can definitely keep peer-reviewed journals before the courts on that particular proposition. Peer-reviewed journals are also accepted as evidence by the court. Suppose the peer-reviewed journal is silent on a point. There is no reference available on a particular point that you have done. Then what do? Then you can always take affidavits from your seniors. Now the seniors can give an affidavit to the court saying that the particular procedure that has been adopted by this particular doctor is correct and I would do the same thing. That also helps in the court. So this is the way you identify how you prove to the court that what you have done is you have practiced as per your standard teaching protocols. This is not negligence. What is the second thing that is not negligence? An error of diagnosis is not negligence. I'm making a very bold statement. We may err in our diagnosis. Is a error in diagnosis negligence is the question, and the answer is very settled. The law is very settled. The law says that if at all we doctors err in our during our treatment, there is an error in diagnosis, there is a mistaken diagnosis. This error in diagnosis or mistaken diagnosis is not negligence. And once again, being a judge-made law, there is a very important nice case on this. I'll tell you what this case was. There was a young boy around 21 years old, tough, nice, robustly built. He suddenly started having pain in his left testicle, severe pain. So what he did, he went to the surgeon and he showed. The surgeon said, this appears to be a case of epididymoarthritis, that is infection of the testes. And he said, we need to admit you and we need to give you antibiotics. He said, yes, the person was admitted, antibiotics, anti-inflammatories, metronidazole, everything was given. First 24 hours, the boy had a lot of relief. But during the second day and third day, the pain started increasing. The moment the pain started increasing, this particular boy lost confidence in the doctor and he said, no, I want to go against medical advice. He took discharge and he went to another surgeon and got himself admitted there. The second surgeon examined him and said, this looks to be a case of torsion testes. It is not epididymoarthritis. So what the second surgeon did was he took him on the table, operated upon him and removed off the testes, which was already bad by this time. It was a case of pakka case of torsion testes. So finally what happened is the boy took discharge and went home, and after he was fully recovered, he filed a case against the first surgeon. He said that, well, you erred in your diagnosis, and as the result of which I have lost one testis now. I am a young man, so now all my problems have started because I am today minus one testis, and therefore you'll have to pay me compensation of an amount of rupees 5 lakhs. Now, how he valued his family jewels to 5 lakh, I don't know. But that is what he said. That is what he said. Now, this particular matter was contested. And the stand taken by the doctor was very simple. Well, he said that an error in diagnosis is not negligence, and there is a small proviso to it. And the proviso is that if at all this error takes place after due application of mind. Now, what do you mean by due application of mind? The law says that due application of mind means you've got to take the history of the patient properly, then you've got to examine the patient properly, then you have to undertake necessary investigations if required, and then come to a reasoned conclusion. And whenever you come to a conclusion by adopting these three steps, your diagnosis will always fall within the ambit of the differential diagnosis. Now, testes, torsion, one of the differential diagnoses is epididymoarthritis. Epididymoarthritis, one of the differential diagnoses is testes, torsion testes. So if at all your diagnosis falls within the ambit of the differential diagnosis, that means that you have definitely applied your mind and come to a conclusion. And when you apply your mind and come to a conclusion, and suppose that conclusion is wrong in the eyes of law, you have done nothing which is incorrect. No compensation will be paid for such errors in diagnosis. But then there has got to be application of mind. Now, I'll give you a very simple example. Another simple example. It is 3 o'clock in the morning. I'm fast asleep. I get a phone from the patient. The phone call says, I've got a lot of epigastric pain. Pain over here. So I say, okay, epigastric pain, it must be acid peptic disorder. And I tell him, you pop in 2 tablets of Digin and come and see me tomorrow. What happens? The patient pops in 2 tablets of Digin, and when the morning comes, the patient is popped. The patient is not there at all. The relatives come and say, the patient is no more. Please give me a death certificate. And I say, well, I don't know what the diagnosis is, as a result of which I cannot give you a death certificate, so do a postmortem. And when the postmortem is done, it is identified that this particular patient has got a massive myocardial infarction. Okay, now the question is, the person goes to the court. And in the court, I take the defense. I say, error in diagnosis is not negligent diagnosis, as a result of which compensation is not payable. But I told you, there is a small proviso to it. And what is that proviso? Error in diagnosis after due application of mind. Correct? And that's what I said. Now the question is, in the second case, can there be due application of mind? On the telephone, definitely you can take the history. But you cannot examine. You cannot prescribe the necessary investigations, and you come to a conclusion, and when you come to the conclusion without adopting these three steps, in the eyes of law, the due application of mind that is required is absent, as a result of which this particular defense of error in diagnosis will not be available to you. Remember this. So telephonic messages and telephonic treatments at times are very dangerous. You must be very careful with this, because as long as nothing goes wrong, everything is fine. But if something goes wrong, God help you. And if at all there is something like this, well, bailing you out from the courts becomes very difficult. Now I'll talk about the third defense. What is not negligence? I'm on that topic now. There is something known as professional discretion that we people have. If at all you adopt your professional discretion and come to certain conclusions, and if there is a catastrophe, that catastrophe in the eyes of law is not negligence, because we are exerting the professional discretion that we have. A very nice case I'll give you on this. See, there was a patient who was suffering from malaria. As a result of which, what happened? Came to the general practitioner. The general practitioner investigated the patient and gave the patient, prescribed the patient a drug known as Remodar. Now this Remodar is a sulfa combination. And when the patient went home and she took two tablets of Remodar, because that is a dose, what happened was the sulfa component in this particular drug reacted. As a result of which, the patient had a full blown picture of reaction to sulfa that is known as Stevens-Johnson syndrome. So Stevens-Johnson syndrome, she came, and both the eyes were involved. She was treated for it. It was identified. But finally, the patient lost one eye. This matter went to the court. Now, in the court, what happened? The patient said, for malaria, there are so many medicines that are available. So many. Why is it that you chose a sulfa combination? You should have given Nivaquin, Camaquin. There are so many things available. This, according to the patient, was negligence on the part of the doctor. And what was the defense that was taken by the doctor? The doctor said that this particular Remodar sulfa combination is one of the established medicines given for malaria. And I have that professional discretion. It is my discretion to choose which medicine I will give to the patient and which I will not give to the patient. As long as my discretion is correct, whatever may be the side effects of this particular problem, that in the eyes of law should never be treated as negligence. That was the defense that the doctor put in. And that defense was so correct, as a result of which even this case was won, and not a single rupee was paid as compensation, in spite of the fact that the patient practically lost one eye. Okay? Now I'll give you another defense. What is not negligence? See, we are professionals, right? We professionals, one of the unique things that we have is that we are not expected in law to give guarantee or warranty with respect to the end results of our services. We are expected to give services, render services. But we are not expected to give guarantee or warranty saying that the end result would be 100% success. No, law does not expect that from us. Now, there is a very beautiful law on this. What is that law? I'll tell you. This is that famous Santra case. What happened here was, this Mrs. Santra was a person who was breaking stones on the road. You know, that beggar, you know. She had 7 children. She said that was enough. Finally, she decided that was enough. So what she did, she went to the primary health center in Haryana and said, I want to undertake a tube ligation. And the tube ligation was done. When the tube ligation was done, she got a discharge card. And in that discharge card, it was written, tube ligation done. Patient went home and it was roses all the way, you know, because then there was no problem of, you know, getting caught. So then what happened? One fine morning, she missed her periods. When she missed her periods, she went back to the primary health center and told the primary health center that, see, I have not got my periods. She showed the discharge card. And you know how things are. You look at the discharge card, TL done. Then those people said, don't worry, nothing will happen. Maybe tumhare mein khoon kam hai. You know, that's a very standard excuse given. So she said, go. She went. And she waited. And she waited for practically 5 months. And after 5 months, when she was around 22 weeks, she came back to the primary health center. And she said, it is now 5.5 months. I have still not got my periods. By that time, the primary health center people examined her, they identified that she was around 22 weeks. At 22 weeks, they could not terminate her. As a result of which, she had to continue this pregnancy till term, and the 8th child was therefore born. So when the 8th child was born, the couple filed a case in the court, and they told the court that, well, we are the only two people who are earning. We have 7 mouths plus 2, 9 mouths to feed. Today what has happened is, we have got an additional mouth to feed, 10 mouths, as a result of which the morsel of every child has automatically reduced because our earnings have not increased. As a result of which, you pay me compensation to take care of this unwanted child who is now a part of the family. This particular matter went right up to the Supreme Court. And you know, I am on the topic of you are not expected to give guarantee or warranty with respect to the end results of our services. This matter went to the court. Now, you know what the Supreme Court said? The Supreme Court heard this matter. And the Supreme Court said, what has happened is very wrong. The Supreme Court was very much aware of this particular proposition of mine. Guarantee and warranty is not required to be given by a medical practitioner. But still, the Supreme Court in this particular case said that this 10th child, the 8th child that has now been born, should be looked after by the state of Haryana and the doctors until the child attained the age of puberty. Something very different, you know, such a judgment was never given. You know, somebody else, gets a child and the doctor and the state of Haryana had to pay compensation for this particular child. Now, you will be thinking, I have told you, this particular proposition, I am not expected to give guarantee warranty with respect to the end results of my services. And you people also know that there is not a single method of tube ligation which is 100% pregnancy proof, correct? Na? Every method of tube ligation has its own failure risk. And therefore, when there is not a single method of family planning which is 100% pregnancy proof, why did the Supreme Court give this kind of a decision is something that you must be thinking. And the answer is very simple. In this case, what had happened was the left tube was ligated, but the right tube could not be ligated because of lots of adhesions that were present. As a result of which, the right tube was left unligated. And what happened? In the discharge card, what was mentioned was tube ligation done. This particular fact that the right tube was not ligated was not mentioned in the discharge card. The Supreme Court said that if at all this particular problem had taken place, then what should have been done was you should have mentioned in the discharge card left tube ligated successfully, right tube could not be ligated because of the adhesions. As a result of which, and subsequent to that, you should have advised her some alternative method of family planning. This the doctors did not do, and this in the eyes of law, in the eyes of the Supreme Court judges, amounted to deficiencies, as a result of which this kind of an order was passed. The order was this 8th child should be looked after until the child attains the age of puberty by the doctors and by the state of Haryana. You know, it's a very dangerous judgment because, you know, failure in tube ligations can take place at the hands of every obstetrician. And if at all he says it has not happened, that means he has not done tube ligations at all. That is the way I look at it. Now see, to prevent this from happening to you, prevent this, what is it that I have always recommended? I have always told my juniors in Somaya Medical College or doctors who always speak to me, I have told them that there are certain things you must mention in the indoor case papers and in the discharge card to prevent such a problem from happening to you. What are these certain things? First thing that you have to mention is you've got to say fallopian tube identified by tracing it up to its fimbria. The moment this is mentioned in the discharge card, what you can tell the court tomorrow is what I have ligated is the tube and nothing but the tube. The second thing that you must mention is you must always say failure risk explained to the patient. This must come in the discharge card. The third thing that you must mention in the discharge card, which is very important, and that is if at all the patient misses her periods, she has to immediately report to you. You know, these three things, if at all you mention in the discharge card and in the indoor case papers, if at all there is a spontaneous recanalization of the tubes, if the tubes join all by themselves, and suppose the patient does become subsequently pregnant, your advocate will have enough ammunition to defend you in the court of law. Otherwise, there's going to be a lot of problems. Like, you know, three children will come and pull your apron and say, Papa, Papa, give me money. You know, I've got to be maintained, and it is your job to now maintain me because I am that unwanted child that has happened because of the tube ligation that you have done. So you've got to be very careful. It really does not work that time. And the last defense, and then I will stop because I know you people are also tired. The last defense is that, you know, anything that we do, the treatment that we give to our patients, all these treatments have their own inherent risk problems. There are inherent risks. There are known accepted complications. If at all one of these inherent risk factors becomes manifest, or if at all one of the known complications, well documented complications, become manifest, in the eyes of law, does that mean that there is negligence is the question. Are you understanding what I'm saying? Answer is 100% it is not negligence, but your case needs to be argued properly. I'll give you a very simple example. See, what happens is, It has been mentioned in the textbooks, and this is a very common teaching in all medical colleges, that primary with a breech and a reasonably sized baby, if possible, try to avoid a vaginal delivery and go in for a section. Around 3.5 kg baby, primary, you know, it becomes a very dangerous proposition. Because of what? Because the aftercoming head can always get stuck. As a result of which, you may either have a dead baby, or if you get the baby out after some time, there might be cerebral palsy in the baby. And it's always better to have a dead baby than a baby with a cerebral palsy. Remember, you know, heroic resuscitation of babies sometimes is dangerous, because what happens is, if at all the baby dies, people forget about it. But if at all there's a baby with a cerebral palsy, every morning the parents get up, they look at this baby, and they will curse you day and night. So it is. I've always been saying that if at all there is a borderline baby, let the baby go. Don't try to give parents a baby which is going to be a liability to them. But that's my view. That's my personal view. But then, if at all there is a known inherent risk factor, and if at all that known inherent risk factor becomes manifest, in the eyes of law, does it mean that there is negligence is the question? And the answer is 100% it is not negligence, provided you have taken the requisite care and informed the patient about this. And this is this very famous example of a primary with breech. So listen to me. A primary, especially the working class, you know, the people who work very hard, people who go homes and do the utensils, clothes and all those patients, people who work on the farm, you know, these people are very, very much against a caesarean section, because they feel that doing a caesarean is going to make them weak, as a result of which they are not able to work on the farm, etc., etc. So they are the ones who always say, I want a vaginal delivery. If that is the case, then you must always counsel them, and you have got to take it in writing from them that we have been explained about the fact that the aftercoming head might get stuck, as a result of which this particular baby might...
An error or an adverse event. Are these three terms defined in law? And please could you give us examples of three clinical situations?
See, negligence is, I've told you what it is. It can be an act of commission, act of omission. You have done something which a reasonable doctor wouldn't do, or you have omitted to do something which a reasonable doctor would do. That is negligence. An act of error of diagnosis.
Not specifically diagnosis, any error where the doctor cannot be blamed.
Correct. So if at all there's an error in diagnosis, you've got to prove the court only one thing, and that is, you have applied your mind and you have come to the diagnosis, or you have applied your mind and you have done what you have done. So if at all it is a reasonable thing that you have done after due application of mind, the law will always excuse you for it. The law will not hold you guilty for it.
Sir, but the expected level of care that a doctor is supposed to give is different at different levels.
Correct. Right? Correct.
From this, the resident, from a doctor.
This is known as the standard of care. You want me to speak on that?
Yes, sir. So, how would the law differentiate?
See, standard of care is a care, is the standard that law expects from you, is the kind of care that law expects from you, and there is never a standardization of the standard of care, because standard of care varies from place to place and from person to person.
Yes.
For example, a person of MBBS, who is an MBBS, the kind of treatment that he gives is something which what an MBBS doctor does.
Yes.
A person who is an MD, the kind of standard that he will exhibit will be much more than that. And a person who is a super specialist, a MCH or a DM, the kind of care that he gives is going to be much better than what an MD gives.
Yes.
So the standard of care will keep on changing with respect to the qualifications. Similarly, the standard of care which a resident doctor will give is something which is much lower than the standard of care which a registrar will give. The standard of care that the lecturer will give will be much better than what the registrar can give. So once again, the standard of care will keep on changing with respect to your expertise and your years of practice. The standard of care also changes with respect to the place where you are practicing. For example, if you are in a Mofussil area where there is no electricity, the standard of care will be much lower than the standard that is expected in a city like Mumbai. Now, in a city like Mumbai, the standard of care that is expected in a small nursing home will be much lower, expected will be much lower than the standard that is expected in a tertiary care center.
So, does the law take that under consideration?
Correct, correct, correct. This is known as that Bolam's law. This particular principle that you are talking about, that the standard of care can keep on changing, is the Bolam's law. And the Bolam's law is very clear. The Bolam's law says, now this is very important, remember, Bolam's law says that the law does not expect the best of the services to be given by the doctor, nor does the law expect worst of the services to be rendered by the doctor. As long as you have rendered reasonable services, that is more than enough. So you have got to tell the court what is mentioned in the textbooks is the best possible treatment that I can give. And the other side of it is going to be the worst possible treatment that I have given, that can be given. If at all I have attained 50% of what is mentioned in the textbook, that in the eyes of law should be reasonable standards. So law expects reasonable standards from you. It need not be the best, neither should it be the worst.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. And if at all the patient's signature is taken on it, then it is a different proposition, because in the courts of law, subsequently if they go, you can always defend yourself properly. But the problem is not that easy. Suppose there's a patient who you have looked after throughout the antenatal period, and she has got breech and she comes in labor. And then you tell her, after coming head can get stuck, I have to do a section. She says, no section. I will not allow you to do section. Deliver me vaginal. You said, all right. You counsel her, put it on the indoor case papers. I have explained all the consequences of the after coming head getting stuck vakara. And then you tell her, you sign. You know what she says? I'm not going to sign. You know, a very common problem that is there. It might not happen in Sion Hospital, but in private practice, this is one of the worst things that can happen. So you write on the paper saying that this is what is going to happen, and you ask her to sign because you've got to take her consent, and she says, I am not going to sign. Then, okay, you say, all right, if that is the case, perfectly all right. Then what you do is, you go to some other hospital. I will discharge you. You know what she says? I'm not going to leave the hospital. She says, you have looked after me right from the first trimester, and now you are asking me to go somewhere else. I'm not going to go. You have to deliver me. Now here is the problem. Because these problems always happen in practice outside. In the institution, you are protected. Outside, you are not protected. Finally, you deliver the patient. Finally, the aftercoming head gets stuck. And finally, you land up with a dead baby. After that, you know what's going to happen? Only two things can happen today. One is a broken doctor or a broken hospital. That is the sad plight of medical practice. Ladies and gentlemen, I'll tell you the last thing before I sum up. See, listen to me. Pointing fingers at others is very easy. It's very easy to point fingers. You know, more so when the patient is a transferred patient. Tum log bahar jaake manjan karke aate hain aur takleef hum logon ko hoti hai. Very standard statements made by resident doctors. See, it is very easy to point fingers at others. Today the problem is with respect to A, B, C, D. And remember that you is somewhere down the line. We all are going to have problems. If at all we as a fraternity can learn to stick together, all our problems will be solved. Today the major problem that we have is because one person starts pointing fingers at the others, and that has made things very bad in the courts of law. I basically defend the doctors and the institutions in the court. I'm having this problem because many times when you read the complaint, you understand that this complaint has not been drafted by advocates, but this complaint has been drafted by a fellow doctor. With that, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much. If there are any questions, I can. Thank you. Thank you. I'm obliged. Thanks.
Thank you so much, sir. May I now request our Dean, Dr. Suleiman Merchant, sir, to please come up on the stage and give sir a token of our appreciation.
Has everybody been attentive here? Thank you for the wonderful lecture. If you are not attentive, then you'll get many papa papa, wiki donors, right? And another important message. Before all the things were important, but one more important thing we learned besides papa papa was value your family jewels a little more.